96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome to the inner city, inner city, inner city.
Good evening, Bahamas, and welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Our telephone lines tonight on Guardian Radio are 323-623-325-4316-325-4259, and you can text us powered by BTC at 422-GR96. I am your host, Valentino Braun, host of the talk show Inside the Inner City, that premieres every Friday at 6:30 to 8 p.m. I just hope today we have a wonderful conversation. Today, there are so many things happening across the country that I don't know what topic to come up with today. So I've decided to come up about development, what is happening in the inner city communities of Nassau and Providence. I'm also going to talk about a little bit about the housing project, because that is what we call, how should I put it, development. So I'm firstly going to start tonight on the Prime Minister's 83 acres residential plan that he is planning to build a subdivision. So let me get the information here. He's planning to build a subdivision, which is very good, and that's part of development. So I'm looking through my phone now, and let me find the information. Okay, I got it. Yes, when we're talking about development, over the past many, many years in the country, we have been trying to find ways how we could develop those persons who reside in inner city community who are under the poverty line. And one of the suggestions that was made over the course of the years is to buy low-cost homes. That is a plan that I think is really great. It would give many Bahamians who don't have a home to actually be able to afford a low-cost home in the country, because there's an ever-expanding population in the Bahamas. You know, we're not a country no more with, 100,000 plus people or more. We have a country now with over 250,000 people living here, and then there's thousands and thousands more living abroad in Canada, the U.S., and many other countries around the world. And we have not been able to keep up with the large population that has been growing in the Bahamas. And for that, we have seen with the COVID-19, how many persons got evicted from their houses. We saw many people got evicted from who were paying rent. We saw many persons who were sleeping in cars. And this should be a concern for our leaders. And if development is not one of our number one priority, then I don't know what is. So I just want to read this article. We got a developer from Awak Homes. It's Awak Homes president, Frank Owen Wilson. That's the son of Frankie Wilson. also the son of Mrs. Cheryl Wilson, Lady Cheryl Wilson, who just got appointed to Lady, who I work with personally on a program many years ago. And he is stating that Prime Minister Dr. Minnis' plan to sell property and invest in New Providence for $50,000 per lot does not help enough people. He could be right about that. I think that this is a great initiative by the Prime Minister at this particular time. But I beg to differ that even though this is a very, very good program for the less fortunate in the country, why was this not done prior to getting elected in the House of Parliament, when the need was very, very great? It's 4 years into term now, and now we're hearing about service lot. We mentioned a few weeks ago, along with Dr. Cesar Nuri, about the homes that were the subdivision that's being built in, I think, Michael Road for 15,000 service lot to, I think, 35,000, which is the next great idea by the Prime Minister. But these things are already supposed to be finished, okay? They're already supposed to be finished. Right now, the Prime Minister is supposed to be giving keys to all of the residents who need a home and who qualified for home. So even though the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas is doing a great job with providing housing and property at a very low price, this should have been done 3 years prior. He should have been. Right now, the Prime Minister is supposed to be sitting on to a subdivision, one of these same subdivision that he's now talking about, and supposed to be giving out keys right now and getting many thanks from persons around the country who need a home and who would being able to get a home. He's supposed to be getting thanks right now. We ain't supposed to be hearing about this 83 acres of land located north of John F. Kennedy Drive between Prospect Ridge and the Ministry of Public Works geared towards young professionals. The developer would benefit about 150 applicants with parcels measuring approximately 95 by 100 feet. Wilson said the biggest challenge people have is coming up with a down payment, which I would agree, and closing costs of purchasing the property. And if the government wanted to help more, it would have addressed that issue. And again, that is a very good point, because right now as we speak with this COVID-19, many people are bankrupt. Who are bankrupt just are backed up with bills, rent, et cetera. I could go on and on and on. We can reflect to the prison officers complaining last week about the harsh conditions. And they're also talking about they need their pay increase, what that they were owed. We saw the nurses, we saw the doctors, we saw the taxi drivers just a few days ago, and et cetera, you go on. There's civil unrest in the country because of this COVID-19. And I don't even think it's because of the COVID-19. I think it's a buildup of previous administration, previous government, not doing the right thing when they're in power. I think that's a buildup from the last administration, and even the one before, because we're going back and forth, but the bills keep piling up. And I would say this is all because of the buildup. And now I think we're the sixth most expensive place to live in the world. So if we're the sixth most expensive place to live in the world, the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of Bahamas shut down the country a few months ago to save lives. And by him saving lives, he also created a lot of hardship and a lot of bills from thousands of Bahamians around the country. And because of that, many people are suffering. I think this is the worst economic time that many Bahamians are going through financially. When we look at the mortgage, person paying mortgage, people paying rent, etc., they're just backed up with bills. And it seems no end in sight. So let me finish reading. Witten said the biggest challenge people have is coming up with the down payment, and if the government wanted to help more, it would have addressed that issue. Part of the closing cost is the government's tax. Once you cross a line, the government is telling you that your path to home ownership is significantly harder, he said in an interview with Guardian Business yesterday. Anytime someone is assisting in home ownership, to me that's a good thing. And it is a good thing that the Prime Minister has decided to go this path. But I think that the government, knowing that it has a growing population, we see the criminal elements in our country, and we know by doing our research that single home kids are more likely to break the law than kids with mothers and fathers. So with that statistics, we know that it comes down to housing and the family structure. So, Okay, let me finish reading. And it is a good thing. And I think that any government coming in, whether you're the Free National Movement, if they're going to repeat as the government, or if the Progressive Liberal Party is going to win the next general election, or the DNA, or the coalition of... boy, it's just rough out here. You know, whoever wins the next general election has their hands full, because I think anyone who comes into power right now, they have to say this to themselves: for the ever-growing population with poverty, you're going to say we're going to have to try to create 1,000 homes per year, or even more. So if you're a government right now in the Cumberland Bombers, if you're not talking 5,000 or 10,000 homes, why you are the government of the Cumberland Bombers, then you're not making no sense. So I can understand why Mr. Wilson is saying this, because, you know, we have a growing population, and we need subdivisions across Nassau. You know, Bahamian should have second and third homes. You know, if you take a look at Abaco, for instance, when we look at Abaco, and we had a terrible hurricane, hundreds of lives lost, communities destroyed, nothing left, right? Could you imagine if many of those residents who were living in Abaco, who are legit Bahamians, who have all their documents and they are Bahamians, could you imagine them getting a warning from the Prime Minister when a warning was given to evacuate Abaco? But many persons couldn't leave Abaco because they had no second home. But we have 700 islands and 700 keys. You're trying to tell me each and every Bahamian in this country who are Bahamians can't have a second and third home on any one of the other family islands, Abaco, Eleuterio, not Spanish Wells, but across the archipelago of the Bahamas. We should be investing in second homes and third homes in the country, just to say if something like a natural disaster was to happen, but we can actually go to one of the next family islands. We don't have to go to the United States of America. We don't have to go to Jamaica. You understand? Because when you have a catastrophic devastation, many people are taken in by other countries. But we have 700 islands, 700 keys that we can develop for second and third homes for Bahamians who live in Nassau, New Providence. So many of us here who are living here, if a hurricane was coming to Nassau, for instance, and I have a second home in Andres, I could leave Nassau or New Providence, leave my home, and take my family to New Providence, I mean to Andres, where the hurricane will not affect. You understand? Or I could go to Miguana or Long Island, anywhere I choose, Cat Island, because I have land. And that is some of the things we have to think about in the country. You know, we have to think strategically. So I'm advising Bahamians out there to go back and look at your crown land or your family land that's on the family island and consider making a second and third home, so that if things go bad in Nassau, New Providence, you can travel to the family island with your second home. You know, I think that's very important, and we need to take advantage of that, because we have 700 islands and 700 keys, and many of us need to take advantage of that. You know, it's very important. Okay. As it stands, conveniences, let me see, long-term leases on real estate property transaction attract value at a tax of 2.5% for properties valued under 100,000 and 10% for properties over 100,000. First-time home owners are exempt from paying taxes on real estate transaction valued below 250,000. Wilson suggests it may be more beneficial to cap that exemption for the first time home buyers, which I would agree. I would agree on that. So, Mr. Prime Minister, if I was you, I would listen to a real estate expert so that they can continue to benefit beyond that threshold. So we could, you know, if we were to take away that, then we will be able to do something else, you know, with the house or with the property. For instance, Wilson suggested government cap the exemption at 10% up to $250,000 and only require first-time buyers to pay on the amount that exceeds the cap. So if you buy a home for $249,000, you don't pay anything. But if you buy a home for $251,000, you pay $25,000 in taxes. Today, if you get that home, that $251,000, the government could say that would cap that exemption. So the government is telling you, look, we'll give you $25,000, and if you can go higher than that, and if you can go higher than we charge you 10% based on how you go. So if you say you want a home that's $300,000, the government will give you your first $25,000, he said. So if your home is $300,000, the tax on that is $30,000. But the government could give you the first $25,000 on that $30,000, and you give me that extra. So the future you go, the further you go, the more you pay. At the end of the day, the goal is to try to get people in homes. And I agree. We have to get Bahamians in homes. We're only talking about who's going to win the next election. That is not important to me. Because whoever wins the next election, I hope they start to say they're going to build up to 5,000 to 10,000 homes in your five-year period, because we have a growing population in this country, you know? And if we want to be able to reduce crime, reduce poverty, we have to empower persons to own their own home and give them an opportunity. So all this exemption can be, how should I put it? Taken away, and like Mr. Wilson is stating, that if the government won't give you your first $25,000, that would give you a big, big jump. I agree. So at the end of the day, the goal is to try to get people in homes. Wilson said when the tax exemption came into effect more than a decade ago, $25,000 could get you a appointed 100 by 100 lot in a desirable neighborhood like, what else? Tarawang Heights. But today, if you look at it, people call around and then they ask what they can get for $250,000. And it's definitely not Tarawang Heights on a 100 by 100 lot, Wilson said. You know that once you cross that line, home ownership becomes significantly more challenging. Added that under his scenario, everyone who's looking to get a home can afford it, whether it's in a government subdivision or a home or out west or out east. Everyone could benefit. That's just one example of how everyone can benefit instead of saying whoever goes in this particular area is great. Minister said on Wednesday that the government purchases would not have to pay government taxes on the properties for 2 years and would have to build their homes within these 2 years. See, you can't put restriction and tell the people that you're going to do all this, and you're rushing them to finish the house in 2 years. See, sir, we're not like you, sir, Mr. Prime Minister. You went out there, and you went to school, you went to college, you got your start from your father and your mother, and you were able to become successful. And every Bahamian wants to be in the position that you're in. But many of us don't have that opportunity, and we don't have that type of support. We're different, sir. So don't demand that we finish in 2 years. Demand probably that if you can get those finished in 2 years, but if you cannot, we try still try to assist you to finish your house in a 4 year or 5 year period, you know. Makes sense to me. Okay. He said that government intends to put all infrastructure in place for the development and lots would be $150,000. However, the government would have the first right of refusal on any property resales. And anyone who wants to sell would have to sell back to the government. And I agree. And I agree. Yeah, you know, I agree on that. Or a slightly higher price that was paid. I can understand the place the government wants to do this from. But to me, I always thought that the goal of government was to help those the private sector could not. And then whoever possible to help the private sector to make home ownership easier for people. Those were what I thought were the two roles. I wasn't aware of the fact that government role was to facilitate things. Government role is not to facilitate things. Government is to provide, not to facilitate. Like he's saying, like you were saying, in 2 year period, if he was to get the lot, you're demanding that we finish the house in 2 period. No, your job is not to facilitate. Your job is to provide the best opportunity for the citizen of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas and to assist them even further after they purchase it to make sure they complete the house in a timely fashion. So you don't want government, you know, dictating to the landowner, you know, because many persons would have to go borrow from their family and friends just to be able to come up with the down payment. So that's very important. That the private sector could readily assist, with Wilson said. And I agree with Mr. Wilson with that face. But like I said, any government that comes to power right now should say to themselves, we have a growing population. We have to provide homes and affordable homes for Bahamian people. So you're going to say, we're going to have to see if we could create 1,000 homes per year. In a 5 year period, getting close to the general election, we should have 5,000 to 6,000 to 7,000, probably with 10,000 homes built for Bahamians in the country. And then, Mr. Prime Minister, instead of you saying these things, that you're getting ready to do these things, just what you're supposed to present close to election. Right now, you could have been saying these homes that we built, I don't know how many homes will be built, but if it's huge numbers, you're supposed to be making your presentation to the news media at this time. You're a little too late, sir. It's a good gesture, and I think it's still going to be a great plan. I don't know if many persons who are interested in the government's proposal at this moment, because many persons are frustrated, and many people might be saying this is about a political advertisement right now to get people to be more on the government side right now. And like I said, Mr. Prime Minister, and to the government, if these houses were built right now, if this subdivision was built right now, and you were on national TV, giving this home to about 200, 300, or 400, or 500 Bahamians right now, or 5,000, or 2,000, or 3,000 right now, or each year, you would be given keys to 1,000 Bahamians in your administration, in the Hubert Alexander Minnis administration during his tenure as Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. When he started and when he finished, every year he would be on national TV giving keys to residents and first-time homeowners. You know, but to say it now, Mr. Prime Minister, I don't know if many persons are going to be interested, but I want to encourage persons out there who are interested, the players go online, check see if you're qualified, and follow up on the service lots, because they are there for you for Bahamians, and try your best to see if it favors you. Okay. On development, I'm going to talk about local government, and this is one of the reasons I was very disappointed with the study on local government. I worked with a team of persons from the Ministry of National Security and the Office of the Prime Minister about 3 years ago. The chair at the time was Senator Renard Hanfield. I worked with Ed Fields, Matt Albury. I work with many persons with local government. It's a caller? They wanna come on the show? Okay, remind me, I gotta talk about local government. Go on, caller. You're on Inside the Inner City. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Wanna come on the show?
Yes, please.
Okay. Go ahead, sir.
Remind me, I gotta talk about local government. Go on, caller.
I'm of the opinion that those houses that was promised by the government are not for Bahamians in Nassau or the Bahamas.
What?
They have to be for American Bahamians or Bahamians who are away, who have already made their money.
What?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
No, I'm saying the houses that have been on the property that have been secured for Bahamians cannot be for Bahamians born in the Bahamas.
What?
They have to be for Americans or Bahamians who are living abroad, who have made their money. They are the only people who can pay for in 2 years and have their house built. That's what I'm saying. Listen, did you have a good show, Glenn? Thank you.
Wow, that's crazy. So those lots in Carmichael Road also, what they talked about a few weeks ago, those service lots also, wow, that is crazy. That is crazy, and thank you very much, sir, for giving all the information. I didn't know that part. For those who go and be successful in those service lots, are for those. Wow, it's crazy. That's crazy. But anyway, when I was talking about development, and then I'm going to talk about, later on the show, I'm going to talk about the development. I'm not waiting on government. I'm not waiting on the MP. I'm sure I'm going to show you the development that we'll be doing in the Grandstand community after we talk about local government, after we take this call. Go ahead, caller. You're on Inside the Inner City. I think the producer is going to let you go in right now. Go ahead,
hey,
sir.
Scrooge.
Hey.
Hey, how you doing, buddy?
I'm fine, sir.
All right, Mr. Lady, you're listening to all over the world.
Okay.
All right, this is Line 1.
Yes, I know the voice, but I never miss the voice.
Okay, respect. All right. Scrooge, I think I don't really normally concentrate on what other people had to say or callers who call in before. That's the man opinion. But Scrooge, I think I catch you talking about what the Prime Minister was offering, the government was offering for young professionals, they call it.
18 to 45.
Oh, that ain't bad. I think it's a good idea, no. And, you know, let's say, election coming up, the people voted this government. They always tell us governance is continuous. A good idea like this, I don't think it matter if the PLP be in power as long as they learn to start to follow good policies with whatever government before them put there.
Make good sense just now. You make good sense, the black man.
Now, Scrooge, one of the things we're talking about too, if the young people can qualify. See, we get this, I don't know if they call it a creature or this entity, we call the Bank of the Bahamas. We hear a lot of times where politicians either take advantage or either who you know and stuff like that. A lot of them had opportunities and either ain't live up to it and still owe in the bank and all that stuff. We should use the Bank of the Bahamas for good things like this. These same 18-year-old professionals, what they call them, and sir, I mean, I hear the caller, I ain't talking about no one in the United States who coming back from it. They included too, but I really talking about these same youngsters who coming out of school, who hear the stories where it was so hard for their parents to own their own homes. To understand that they get the opportunity from the government of the Bahamas. It doesn't matter if the Free National at the moment is the party what's saying it. But the government of the Bahamas offering the opportunity for young professionals to own. And they're saying that the value could be like $100,000 if they qualify and all that. What I think the government should do is make them qualify by working with that creature, like I call it, the entity, the Bank of the Bahamas, to guarantee the loan for them.
Yes.
Just like I just need someone to stand with you, the government to stand with them. The Bank of the Bahamas, all kinds of opportunities, you know, rich people who might have been in better position to these young so-called professionals today who need the opportunity. Why not take a chance with them and guarantee the loan? They don't have to go to no commercial banks and all the other rest of banks. They could go right through the Bank of the Bahamas and be qualified. Some of them are police officers. Some of them are young nurses. Yes. Some of them are young teachers. Some of them work for government, you know, in the sanitation department and stuff like that. Let's give them a chance. So I salute the government for doing this. And I just saying, if the people do decide and put the PLP in there, I think there's something with Brave Davis them need to continue.
They should continue it because right now, you know, we're not a country of 100,000 persons no more. We're a country now with 250,000 living here.
Yeah. So maybe even almost close to
half a million. Half a million.
Mm-hmm.
You're so correct. And we have to be able to set an example to make sure that they're taken care of in the country. And you're correct. You're right, the blind one. Go ahead, blind one. You still there? Okay, we're going to take this next call. Go ahead, caller. You're on Inside Inner City.
How you doing?
I'm fine, sir.
All right, so I like what you're all talking about. I do think that the prime minister is doing a great job. I'm disagreeing about the government interfering with the bank. Because if the government interferes with the bank, then the government is going to have to also help pay these loans when people can't afford to pay them. So I think what it is that once we scrutinize the payments, make sure all these professionals are able to make the payments.
Mm-hmm.
That's more important than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
I think the F&M government did a good job by doing this. Mm-hmm. The next government coming in, let me tell you how they're going to win this, Scrooge. You listening to me?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
The next government would come in. Now, Scrooge, I want you to hear this very carefully.
I'm listening.
Okay?
I'm excited. I'm listening. I'm smiling right now. Go ahead.
Scrooge, if you want to win the government, and I give this to the F&M, the DNA, the PLP, whoever, we own 3 million acres of land. Give each Bahamian with four generations of Bahamian parents.
Yes.
Each Bahamian, which is almost 400,000 Scrooges.
Yes.
It's not quarter million. It's 400,000. We're up there now. Almost 500,000.
Okay.
Give each Bahamian 1 acre of land. 1 acre of land on the family island.
Mm-hmm.
That'll help to empower them. Give them that. That only 500,000. We have over 3 million acres of land
mm-hmm.
that are owned by the Bahamian people.
Wow.
Wouldn't that empower them, Scrooge? You
yes.
don't think so?
Yes, because I can leave from Nassau and go travel to the family and set up my cottage.
Okay.
Or my Airbnb. Brilliant.
Right. So, Scrooge, you was talking about how you could have your second home.
Yes.
If the government think about it, Bahamians could have second home.
Yes.
If you give them each acre of land. And
yes.
let's start doing some proper thinking, Scrooge, okay?
Yes.
If we say we're gonna develop Andrus, start giving out the land in Andrus. And then give little incentives to businesses like, you know, the JBRs and the Super Value
yes.
to own a piece of property to start developing land so we could come off this little rock. Because this little rock, Nassau,
ain't making no
is
sense
becoming
right
overdeveloped.
Yes, over the... You're so correct, sir.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes,
we need to move off this little land.
Yes, we have to.
We keep thinking about how we can develop this little Nassau. And I'm not saying Nassau is a beautiful place.
Too much
but
people,
I'm telling
man.
You, it's getting so crowded.
It is small no more. It's not small no more. Nassau's not small no more.
It's tiny.
It's not small no more.
So, Scrooge, that plan what you was talking about, I like that. I don't normally call the show. I listen to you a lot.
Yes, sir.
But I call the show just to let you know that second home that you're talking about.
Yes, sir.
I hope the government starts thinking about at least trying to give some Bahamians an acre of land.
Yes.
1 acre of land. That's only 400,000 acres.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
We own over 3 million acres.
3 million acres. Wow.
That's something to
That's
think
crazy.
About. Scrooge, I want to hear what you got to say about that.
Okay.
God bless.
Okay, thank you. We can take this next call, and I'm going to comment on that. Caller. Go ahead, caller.
Hey, Scrooge.
Hey.
Hey, sorry, I'm about you to go on there. I just a wrap up right now, right?
All right.
Yeah, the caller say something just now, but I just want to say something quickly. This thing ain't for no second home buyers, right? It's for first home buyers, right?
No, I just was adding a part on.
No, but that's what we need that too. Scrooge.
We need that too. We have to.
Yes, Scrooge, people like me or you might have our little shack or what we call our palace. People might consider it as shacks. Yeah, we should have the opportunity to for the whole Bahamas and Scrooge. All us ain't got to be staying right here.
No, we don't need to.
Yeah, we ain't got to be in Nassau. We can need to, correct, but we can do this thing on the family island second home, even if we rent it or whatever. We need government. We need governments or people in there who will help us empower ourselves and do it the right way. Good. One last thing, what I want for the battery to go on there. The health officials are saying that the COVID numbers are rising, more people getting in the hospital, might be hospitalized or whatever, being tested and different things. You still there, right?
Yeah, I'm still.
Okay. When I hear that on the news and stuff like that, right, I start thinking about what are the people doing? Because I hope we ain't letting our guard down. Then I remember what's going on right now. We have a lot of yellow and a lot of red campaigning on the road. And I wonder if these
What campaign? Campaigning? The Prime Minister stated there's no campaign going on.
But they're moving around and...
No campaign. You got to take what the man said. That's the Prime Minister.
I can't see, so I have to hear what he says. But I'm saying they could be super spreaders. And I think knowing that they're advising us to take the COVID-19 shot, any candidate, independent or for any major political party, they should be first on the line to take the COVID-19 shot. And before they come to our houses talking about they won't vote, this is a serious situation. They don't tell us, the health official, don't let people to your house. This ain't the time to be traveling around again, the people house and different things. But for some reason, they feel like it's important that they got a campaign, so at least they got to put their guard on. Just like how they say, well, wear your condom or put on your mask. They need to take their shot before they come to these people house because they could be super spreaders, Scrooge. Keep up the good work. Have a nice weekend, my buddy.
Okay, thank you very much. You're making me laugh so much. Listen, Prime Minister State is not campaigning spirit right now. But again, you don't know what to believe in the country. They're saying one thing, and then we're seeing the DNA, we're seeing the Free National Movement, we're seeing the Progressive Liberal Party on through Facebook. So I don't know what you call campaigning right now. To me, because look like it's not campaigning. It's not going door to door. It's not talking and presenting candidates, going in the community, candidate who is representing the community in the community, introducing to the residents. And we've been seeing it all over Facebook, so I guess the Prime Minister is completely correct, and there's no campaigning season right now. That's all I can say. Yeah, and to the caller, earlier, and he talked about the fact that he don't call in the show. Well, I'd just like to say this to you. It's great that you did call in because you made it some valid points. And, I just don't know. I just hope that whoever wins the next general election decide to say that they will consider crying line on the family island for Bahamians who are here to go and build a second home on the family island. Because again, if disaster strikes us, like how it happened in Abaco and Freeport, we have 700 islands, 700 keys, and it's many more than I heard. It's more than 700 islands, more than 700 keys. Okay, some are populated, some can be developed. We can develop cities with low-cost homes, with cafeteria, with barber shops, with food stores, with hardware stores, with restaurants, with home businesses, all around the country. In Cat Island, could be in Gizuma, Meguana, could be in Auckland, and we could give Bahamians the right to choose where they want to go and live in the Bahamas or to have a second home, so that if we have a catastrophe like a tsunami, or an earthquake, or et cetera. And it happens in National Providence, but we are resilient, and we can just live in our boats, live in our planes ahead of schedule, so that we keep ourselves safe and keep our family safe. So definitely, we have to consider these things. Caller stated that we're close to 500,000 persons residing in the country. So we have to think for the future, and what the Prime Minister's suggestion is a good gesture. But like I said before, if you're not talking 1,000 homes built every year, why is you in power? And just say 5,000, you could do more. You could say 10,000 homes in 5 years. And I think that should give you enough clearance to actually win the next general election. But as the Prime Minister is a little late on this, He should have been on this from at least 3 years ago, and now he's supposed to be handing keys over to a few hundred Bahamians across the archipelago of the Bahamas right now. And you would see how many persons would have tell him thanks. And we who do not believe in the government would start to say, hey, man, that's a good thing, seeing our fellow Bahamians get some keys to their house. Those kids are happy. The grandmother's happy. Many persons are happy in the country. And that's what we want to see, you know. Talk is cheap. And this is going to happen. I think that, yes, subdivisions are going to be built. But it might go into the next term. It might not be this government in power. I don't know. We all right now are having our conversation on who is going to win the next general election. Many persons say the PLP is going to win the next general election. Many persons say the Free National Movement, if they do some good things right now, they can win the next general election. They're saying the DNA with leader Ms. Kumalafe stand a chance of swinging votes on the side of the DNA so that the Progressive Liberal Party can win the next general election. You know, something that went down when Brendan McCartney was leader of the DNA, I think they got 10,000 to 15,000 votes, and that swung the election. You know, it swung the election. And I think that was one of the reasons the Progressive Liberal Party won that election. It seems like more persons now are leaning towards voting for the DNA. So we could probably have 10, 15,000, probably even 20,000 people vote for the DNA. And if that happens, you know what happened, I think of 10 years ago, 15 years ago, it swings the vote if it's a close election, because we know that we have 50,000 people on the FNM side, we have 50,000 on the PLB side, and the swing over the DNA could actually swing it to the opposition or to the governing party. So I don't know. Are we going to take this call? Go ahead, caller. You're on Inside the Inner City.
Hello, Scrooge. How you doing?
I'm fine.
Everything cool?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, like I say, listen to the conversation.
Yes.
The good things, even the prime minister have for the people.
Yes, you could talk. You could, if you don't mind, you could talk up just a little bit, please.
Okay, you hear me better now?
Just a little. I know you're nice, polite. You're nice, polite, but just a little bit more.
Okay. You hear me better?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because the reason why I said is if the governments who come in power or who are in power, who have been in power before, if they can't handle this country as small as it is, what make you think they can handle other places, like you say, cities, other places on that island?
Yes.
They can't handle this one. We'll be in trouble if we get something seriously happen on the island over here, because if we can't bear and handle this little small country, you know, and have no government or no ministers who could work on those islands and make it better, would make us think, you know what I mean? Imagine all them islands fill up. We just can't handle this little tiny little city. You got all kind of entertainers with talents. You got to find these talents. Only way we can get up is through talent. You know, anyway, that's all I have to say. Take care.
Yes, sir. It's just crazy. And good, great point. We have to develop the family islands with low-cost homes across the archipelago to the Bahamas, and wider to less fortunate Bahamians. And any Bahamian who qualifies, and if you're not qualified, the caller suggests that the government should assist in helping you get qualified. No one should be turning away as long as you're a Bahamian. They talked about four generation. The caller talked about four generation. If you're four generation Bahamian, you was here before 1973. That means you were British, and you're entitled to a low-cost home. Yes, he's correct, because your generation spans before independence. So you were British, then you became a Bahamian. And yes, you should be qualified to be able to get a low-cost home. And the caller called just now, I want to make reference to this. Yes, we can deal with all the problems we have here in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. But you can imagine if we had local government set up where we have persons from administration and the community on board in these particular islands where these low-cost homes are being developed, and it would be more up to them to do the survey to see how much persons are eligible to get a low-cost home in the family island. So we need local government. And you remember I talked about local government. Local government is one of the programs that a few of us got together by the IDB Bank. Me personally sat down with IDB Bank about 7, 8 years ago. They were asking my input on inner city community. How could we can improve the conditions of the inner city community? And I explained to them what the problem we were facing when it comes to housing. And I told them that many of the problems we face in the country when it comes to criminal activity is based upon the family structure being destroyed in the country. And I gave my input. And I started to talk about all the stuff that I was doing in my particular community that I reside in, because I don't wait on government. All right, I live in the Lewis Street, Hay Street, and Taylor Street area. I work along persons like Pastor Hugh Rule, from East Street Gospel Chapel Church. I work along with Pastor Ari Cooper from Mission Baptist Church. I work along with Mr. Ferguson, former Assistant Commissioner of Police, Woods Ali. I work with those prestigious pastors. I also work with IDB Bank. I work with the Bahamas government when they need my input on how to make things happen in the city community. And one of the things we talked about was when I was at IDB Bank, I talked about how we can empower Bahamians. And they said, wow, you does all those stuff in your community, because I do sporting events, I do development, I do empowerment, right? So I explained all this to them. And I said that you could imagine if we were to get local government in the inner city communities that we reside in, where we have a council board, group of community leaders, along with partners from the government, sitting on to the table and saying, hey, we have 10 lots in our community, right? They're abandoned. 5 of those lots has abandoned houses. Owners have not been checking for the property for the last 25 years. What if we find out who the owners are, purchase these homes, look for persons in the community who are Bahamians, who are in need of a house, who are in dead need of a house, find out if there's any disabled persons in the community, right? Or old persons in the community who are paying rent, but they are Bahamians, and they need an opportunity to better themselves. We asked the Board of Local Governors would sit down and recommend that, hey, we could clean on this lot here. Let's purchase those 5 lots. Let's turn those into low-cost homes. And let's present those low-cost homes to this elderly person who resides in the community, who has no home, who's still paying rent. Let's give it to this person who's disabled. So we make use of our community. Instead of all those run-down houses where everyone is sharing garbage, we can use those as to rejuvenate the inner-city community. See, so that's why I said local government is very important. That's why I was very disappointed at this particular administration, because working with IDB Bank made this recommendation to the office of the prime minister. I was there. I was the main person sitting on, me and my friend Hugo George was there instructing the IDB Bank. I'm doing this with my influence. Okay, this is what I'm giving back to my country as a citizen. I'm giving them my ideas and my input. This is powerful. When you say you want change, you don't have to be running for political office, trying to be a candidate to make change. I've made so many changes in this country that are helping the Bahamian people today that people don't even realize that it's actually God put wisdom, knowledge, and understanding in me. And my heart is for my brothers and sisters in this country. My heart is not for power. My heart is not for fame. My heart is not for riches. My heart is to see people happy and living good, because I'm tired of seeing the cries and sorrow and the suffering and how we're destroying one another in this country. And I can't take it as a citizen. I came from a life where I was a very violent person. I never had a mom and dad who I could say is my mom and dad. I had a grandmother and auntie and uncles who loved me, but I never had a mother's love. I never had a father's love. I would never say I grew up in a family home. I grew up in a home, but my mom and my dad were not there. Okay, I can't tell you if I wake up one day in my life and saw my mom, my mother holding me or my father holding me. I don't know how that feels. But what I miss and I see how the kids going through, that hurts my heart. And all I want to do is make a difference. So local government is one of the avenues that I think could make a big change in the country. For whatever reason, Bernard Hanfield was the chairman of local government. We had Ed Fields there. We had Sustainable Governance there, Matt Albrey. We had Dr. Nikolai, and many more government officials along with community-minded persons were there. And we came up with a great plan for local government to be introduced in Nassau, New Providence. For some strange reason, I started to hear that the government officials were afraid because we were saying we're taking power away from the politician. I don't understand why we'd be taking power away from the politician if we're the ones who are going to be on the ground. The politicians would be in parliament debating on the funds that we're going to need to do all these projects in the community, do the sports program, to redevelop one of the homes, to be creative, to create, clean up the neighborhood, to provide speed bumps, to make sure all the houses get water, running water, make sure all the houses in the community get electricity, make sure that the parks get Wi-Fi, make sure that our roads stay maintained, you know? And that is one of the things we presented to local government. So we're going to pause on this and we're going to take this call. Go ahead, caller. You're on Inside
Hello,
Inner City.
George, how are you doing?
I'm fine.
I know the voice very well, and I believe I could place that voice with the face that I know. But nevertheless, not at this time.
Go ahead.
The reason why successive government has not allowed local government to play a pivotal role in New Providence is because they were always challenged by local government, including Hubert Ingram, who brought local government into being. They knew that if local government had ever come into Nassau, either the candidate for every constituency would have had to perform and do their duties as it relates to their constituency, or the persons who work in local government in the constituency, like the garbage collector, the one who cleaned the side bridges of the street, the one who cleaned up the graveyard, and the people who see that things be done in the community, they would have been the people who would have been voted to be re-elected or to get elected as a representative for each constituency. But that's their greatest fear. They don't never, ever want Nassau to realize. But guess what? It's coming, you know.
Mm.
It's coming sooner than later. And everyone who is a candidate for any constituency, they will have to perform. And I'm talking about perform at its highest level, brother. Nassau could be decent, cleaner. Nassau could be one of the true paradise of the world. But now it is so filthy, it has to be cleansed and clean out for it. And then you will see a new city. As a matter of fact, you will see new cities all over the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is coming sooner than later.
Wow. Yes. And I'm glad you said that. Coming sooner or later. See, for me, I'm doing that now in my constituency. The caller's talking about how the area needs to cleanse and clean. We've been cleaning now in the Grandstand area for 10 years. And for the last 6 months, my private sponsor, who I've talked to privately, you know, a husband and wife team from Life of Key, talked to them. They made suggestions, and we're working together on how we're going to actually do our own local government. I'm actually doing local government in my community that I reside in right now. Okay, cleanup program that we're doing now in the Grandstand area that is private, not sponsored by government, that's private by a husband and wife team who are supporting me and my endorsed to develop the community that I reside in. So I'm taking responsibility for the community that I reside in. Okay, the caller talked about, the previous caller before this one talked about the spread of COVID-19. So I got a text here from Mr. Smith, and he said, probably the COVID-19 is spreading because we're not asking face masks for church. Okay, and the campaigning and et cetera. And we're dropping our guard. We're dropping our guard in the country. You know why we're dropping our guard in the country? Because many people believe that the COVID-19 pandemic is a hoax. Okay? So many people are reluctant to do the proper protocols, because now with hard times, with all the, it could be true news or false news, So it contradicting one another. So this is very confusing for me as a citizen, for many other citizens in the country. So we confused. We didn't know what to believe. You know, that's last the prime minister stating that it's not going to be early election. He might be correct, but he also stated that there's no campaigning going on, but yet still we're seeing the machine of the Free National Movement walking through the communities, and we're seeing the machinery of the Progressive Liberal Party. They're saying an early election. The Free National Movement saying this is not campaigning right now, but who could you believe? Let me ask any one of y'all. Can we believe the Prime Minister? Can we believe that the Prime Minister is telling the truth? But we see him with our own eyes on Facebook, et cetera. They're walking around in big groups. So you don't know what to believe. You don't know, the word of leaders no more don't mean nothing. You know, one time ago when leaders used to speak, you respect what the leaders say. But nowadays when the leader speaks, you don't even hear nothing they say no more because so much lies. I'm not saying minister told lies or Perry told lies. We could come to our conclusion. All of them told lies to us over the course of the last 15, 20 years. We have been lied to over and over. So this is not something that, it's just like you're crying wolf now. You know, so we don't know who to trust right now. You know, the Prime Minister could be saying the truth, but with all the lies that are being told from both sides over the course of the years right now, we can't take the word of our leaders no more. That's how the value of our leaders drop in the country. After Sir Lyndon and after Ingram, it seems that the value of leaders here in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas has gone to the dogs. That's it. You know, gone to the dogs. People don't respect what the leaders say no more. If you listen to social media and you listen to some of the comments that citizens be making towards the Prime Minister and the leader of the opposition, it's heartening. Even me as a radio personnel would never go to extend us to be really, really disingenuous, saying bad things with the Prime Minister, cursing the Prime Minister. I have respect. I don't hate the Prime Minister. I don't hate the opposition leader. I just don't like the way how they do business. You know, for me, who is a citizen, I have seen what I've accomplished just working as an individual. I've seen what I've accomplished working with numerous government over the years, okay? And many laws that were passed in the House of Parliament was because of me, both with the PLP and Free National Movement. That is benefiting people today. And I can name many. Lucas Holmes, we talked about it in the show. We talked about empowering the inner city community. We talked about local government. We talked about the Urban Design Lab, which is the Orville Initiative. And that's my input, working along many other different organizations to create such a urban design for the Bahamas. And then that turned over to the Orville Initiative. So I could go on and on. We have started the urban renewal with former Prime Minister of the country, Perry Gladstone Christie. That was all I had sitting under the table many years ago. That is benefiting Bahamian people today. Many people will know that, you see? But that's us as young persons wanting to do better for our country. In turn, that has helped thousands of people. You understand? When we talk about urban renewal, you know, because that's us sitting down with Mr. Christie, telling Mr. Christie, empower us so we could go in the community and fix those houses that need repair. And that's why urban renewal started, sitting down with Mr. Christie. That didn't start from no government. That started from young guys who were on the streets, who had a vision and know how to present their vision to the leader. And he himself got in power, and he made that happen. Now, it didn't go the way it's supposed to go, but it still benefit people. So all those sources you see when it comes to urban renewal, that is Mr. Christie, and that is many young guys like myself who gave that information to Mr. Christie so he could come up with a great idea about urban renewal. So that's us. Okay, I'm being involved with so many different programs in the country. The producer is playing the music, so we have to take a break. So please don't go away. We'll be right back on Inside the Inner City. In the heart of the city.
So, Gianna, how often have you been flossing? Well, you know that's not enough. And are you still working over at the daycare? Okay. How's Franklin? Haven't seen him at the club. I see. How are your boys doing? Okay. Sounds good. Now you just tell me if this hurts. Oh, boy. That's a doozy. Did I ever tell you about the shark I found in my pool?
With 99% of medical claims paid in under 5 days, we're like a dentist that doesn't try to talk to you with your mouth full.
Sounds good.
CG Atlantic. Insurance, health, pensions, life. Good like that. Atlantic Medical Insurance Limited, trading as CG Atlantic Medical and Life. Security and General Insurance Company Limited, trading as CG Atlantic General. Coral Isle Pension Services, Bahamas Limited, trading as CG Atlantic Pensions. And Nassau Insurance Brokers and Agents Limited, trading as CG Atlantic Agents.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
We're back on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My producer, Mr. Kermit, is in studios. He's one of our best producers. He does a wonderful job, so I have to show my respect to him. And I was talking about how many programs that I have helped introduce on behalf of the Bahamian people. I want you to bear in mind, I did this because I know I had influence. There was no money involved. This is just me taking that opportunity. This is more important than money. I was looking out for the future development of our country. So any one of these things you see me talked about, whether it was 25 years ago or 20 years ago, it was all to benefit each and every one of us in this country. I do it because I just feel like that I owe the Bahamas something. I owe the world something. You know, when I go to talk about local government, Renard Hanfield was the chair, Ed Fields, and we sat down and we discussed that. And the caller who called earlier, he stated that they didn't want local government in the country. And you know, the fact remains that we got a message stating that the MPs who were part of the government were afraid to dilute power to local government here in Nassau, New Providence, because they say it's going to take away the power from the MPs. But here's this. If you're an MP and you're running in Bahamas, you have a local government board. The local government board is to make sure that things get handled in the community, whether it comes to speed bumps, whether it comes to abandoned lots, whether it comes to home repair, whether it comes to maintaining the community and what the community needs to move forward. If we're on the ground and we're working and we're giving this information to the representative of that community, and we're saying to him, hey, like I said before, we have 5-10 yards, we like to get the funds together, purchase this lot, and give it back to a less fortunate person in the community. Well, we're doing the minister's job, and all the minister's doing is going in cabinet when he goes to cabinet or when he goes to the house, and he speaks on behalf of the budget that needs to be in the hands of the local government so that we could go and do these projects. And at the end of the day, the same MP who say we're taking power away from the government will be the one presenting the keys to the residents of these homes, or to any home repair, or any speed bumps, or any activity you do in the park, that he goes in parliament and he asks for a budget for C.B. Moss. He asks for a budget for Valentino Brown. He asks for a budget for Salem Union Baptist Church. He asks for a budget for Mission Baptist Church. And those budget, the prime minister of the country with an intern, look at the presentation, and he himself will decide or not if he is going to be able to give the allowance. This was done in the case of Pricewell Forbes. Pricewell Forbes was able to help build that gymnasium that you're seeing now in Andres when people are saying he's not doing the job. But you imagine being in opposition and still being able to work with the prime minister. Notice, Pricewell Forbes is still working with the prime minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, which he is in a different party. Pricewell is in the PLP, but Pricewell still is using his influence to ask the prime minister to help assist him in finishing his gymnasium for the people of Andres. And he has been doing that for the last 15 years when he worked with Ingram. When he asked, I think for the park, he asked for some assistance. I was on the news and I was watching, and he made his budget debate in Parliament. And he asked Honorable Hubert Ingram if he could assist on the budget to build a park in Andres. And Ingram, in turn, even though the Pricewell was the opposition, he assisted Pricewell Forbes. You understand? Because Pricewell Forbes made a budget for his community. And as opposition, and the prime minister has to heed and listen. And if it makes sense, he will support it. We're going to take this call. Go ahead, call you on Inside the Inner City. Kermit, you could take this call if you could. Sorry. Go ahead, call you on Inside the Inner City.
Good evening. Scrooge.
Hey.
Sparky.
Where you been, man? You ain't bring me on cool 6 o'clock, man.
I just got one in Monroe. I'm on row with one of your boys the other day.
All right.
On Pride of State Park, we'll bring some horses around here with the children.
That's Nate. That's
that.
Nate.
That was you talking to me?
No, that was Nate.
Yeah, because it looked like he's got a violent attitude.
That's Nate. That's Nate.
I tell him, you always be talking all this nice thing about attitudes and everything. And I tell him, why you don't call Scrooge? I say, every time I call Scrooge, if I say something wrong, Scrooge cut me off.
Not
well,
me.
It looked like he wanted to fight. I say, hold on, man, hold on. You be on the talk show. You talk, that's Scrooge. See, you got to be real in this country, you know.
Oh, Lord.
When you're on this talk show talking so nice, but when you leave the talk show and you go in the real world and somebody says something you don't like, you won't fight.
Well, who's that?
I don't know, one fellow with some horse down here with the children. Okay. But anyway, that's a neat joke.
I know. That's your boy.
That's a neat joke.
I know, man, Sparky.
No, like he won't fight me because I let him use cut me. Like I said, no, Sparky, me don't do that. I said, the fellow done bawly fast. I said, holy, I mean, he might be right in the studio with you. But it's good.
Yes, sir, go ahead, Spark. Use my boy, he's big, but after.
Scrooge.
Yes, sir.
Let me tell you something. We so mixed up. I mean, contrarian is a joke. When you we need another name for another salad bar. I really don't know. Because contrarian is light.
It's light for what's
we so mixed up in the Bahamas.
Yes, sir.
We so corrupt.
Yes,
we
sir.
Lie.
Yes.
From the church.
To the politician.
From the from the bishop of the Catholic Church and the bishop of the Anglican Church.
He went to the courts.
And all of them, they who don't want no taxi plate, don't want no land, and this and that and the next. All them are friends, family, lovers, and then they pass it down to the politicians. They don't care about none of us. Scrooge, if you've been around long enough like me and you, you could tell they don't care about none of us. All they want is they big house. They big car and everything, and then they suck up to the foreigner, the white man, the Chinese, and everything. They don't care about us. They just want their little 5-year House Assembly, and they say, if you get me back, if I didn't do good in the first 5 years, and you put me back then, if I don't make that big haul the next time, then you throw me out. So you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? If the fella ain't getting first haul in the first 5 years, and you put him back in there,
is he time
you know he can do a second time, right?
Is he time now?
The first time they say it was the people time.
Yeah.
The second time is he time. It's good. Stop saying he can get a yacht now. He can get a yacht now. And he can get a condominiums. He can get a condominiums up behind the Prime Minister building and Prospect Ridge.
Uh-huh.
Overlooking the beach.
Uh-huh.
Then he going down by Dogon Traveler's Rest and build a big Dogon Castle up on top of the hill.
Uh-huh.
Look at it. He can see Florida.
Uh-huh.
He's so high up in the air.
And they want us to see Florida, Sparky.
Man, they don't even want us to see Bay Street. Look here. I can tell you one thing.
Yes,
the
sir.
Worst person in the world to trust is a black, picky-haired Bahamian man.
But no, they say the white man, but so the
no, but screw it.
It ain't a white man, it's the one, the pickier one.
But look here, screw it.
Yes, sir.
I can understand the white man situation.
Uh-huh.
They don't like us because of our color.
Right.
They belong to the Queen and all the Philip and all that. Even the Queen's son don't even want nothing to do with him out.
Grandmother.
That's his grandma. Because he doesn't find out he can never be king.
Right.
So him and Meghan, they say they could just leave them and they go Meghan, they can live off the Meghan. Because the Queen doesn't say, I gave you no money. You go live off Meghan money.
Uh-huh.
So Meghan say, you know, I said, I'm an actress. I could make some money. But Harry say, man, look here. Mom, grandma. See you later. I gone. I go into Canada, United States, and Charles and all of them, they can stick around there because they going to live up in Buckingham Palace.
Mm-hmm.
But the worst person to trust is a black man, especially if there's a Bahamian. If they got crooked toe, and they got picky head, and they got D&E average, and dry leg, screw it, me and you know them.
Yes, sir.
Don't turn your back on them, because if they ain't got a gun, they got a dagger. They could kill you because they believe in friends, family, and lovers. Every prime minister we put down there, check all their record. Friends, family, and lovers. Don't trust the screws. I won't cuss, but you know I can't cuss on God in radio, right?
I can't even get your finger up right now.
But screws, don't lie. You know... Boy, that word I want to use has got four letters. You know we are. Bye.
Oh, Lord. Oh. Yes. Excuse me, general public. I was killing myself laughing. Sometimes you just need that, you know. Oh, Lord. Okay. Yes. Woo. All right. So maybe yes now. Like I was saying, I was talking to my local government, and I was highly disappointed in hearing that they turned it down. Renard Hanfield was very disappointed. Matt Albury from Sustainable Government, from AUG, he was disappointed. Ed Fields himself was disappointed. Many of us were disappointed because it was a foolproof plan to empower the communities to make sure that local government would be the eyes and ears of the community so that we could bring our budget presentation to the member of parliament who, in turn, would do similar to what Pricel Forbes did, you know. And Pricel Forbes was an excellent minister because I don't want you to think for a minute I've been in a gymnasium of that magnitude is something easy to do. You know, it takes a lot of negotiating. It takes a lot of time talking to the leader and the government, talking to Minister of Public Works, who actually is the government, but it's your nemesis, and you have to put that aside. And Pricewell Forbes leads that example in Parliament. But anyone in the Progressive Liberal Party, you know, I highly respect Pricewell Forbes because I know and I studied him, and he was a good friend of mine's, and it teach me on how I need to do things in my particular community. And I know how to make a presentation, you know, and he made budget presentation for the projects he was doing in his constituency for the community. And these are his ideas that he put forward because he know what the community needed, just as well as how I know what the community needed in Grandstand, Lewis Street, and Hayes Creek. And Pricewell Forbes did a remarkably great job because, you see, the presentation of the gymnasium with the government the other day, him walking alongside the Honorable Hubert Alexander Menace. And Menace himself is supporting Pricewell Forbes. And this is what we want when you become government. When you become government of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, you're neither PLP, you're neither Free National Movement, you're neither DNA. You are for the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Your job is once you win the election, you're no more the Free National Movement leader until it gets time to election. You understand? So when you once you get elected as the government, you're no longer the leader of the Free National Movement no more. You are the leader of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Your job is to make sure transparency goes across the board with opposition and government officials, government ministers. Equal opportunity for all sides. And then, when you get close to 4 years, then you start to speak again on behalf as leader of the Free National Movement. There, you talk about all the accomplishment that you have already done for the people of the Bahamas. And then, it's up to the Bahamian people to decide if you did a wonderful job and deserve to have a second chance. Not for you now, Prime Minister, to come down and talk about low-cost homes. These things were supposed to be done over 3 to 4 years ago. And that's why I'm really upset. I'm upset with local government when they turned that down. And I want to talk about what the plans are for the community that I reside in, okay? If you look at Grandstand, which is closer to Bay Street, and with the country now opening up with the COVID-19, and we have now the AstraZeneca vaccine, which is an alternative so that we can have guests arrive in the country and to get back to normal capability. The government now and the cruise ship industry are working on strategic plans on how they could get the industry back. Diagla talked about it. Minister Diagla talked about it. Minister of Tourism Diagla talked about it. And development has already taken place. If you look at on top of East Creek, ahead of the police barracks, you would see that the post offices has just been torn down. And they'll be putting up a building there. I don't know what structures you're going to pull up, but that's development. Across from that is the U.S. Embassy. If you walk further down the road, on the same road, you'll see that the government house now is being repaired. We saw the Speaker of the House talked about some of the conditions, and the government is taking an initiative now to repair government house. And they've been working on government house now for the last four months, as you can see. So we have the U.S. Embassy being constructed. We have the old post office being torn down and the building is going there for redevelopment. We have the government house being renovated. We have the government grant at the Archbishop William Thompson Park, which is situated in Grandstand, is also being rebuilt as part of the Overdale Initiative. So development is happening. And what I'm doing in the community that I reside in, because everything that I've done over the years comes down to one thing now. All of my research, all of my programs have come down to one thing. We have to provide opportunities because of the high unemployment in the country. So I've worked up the plan, and I said to myself that if I could get the tourists that are 400 steps away, 400 steps means if I take 400 steps with my foot, 400 steps could take me to Bay Street from where I live in Grandstand. That is in range where I can get the guests when the country reestablishes itself with 7 million visitors, like we broke the record year before last. And if we get that growth again, with visitors reaching our shores, I am working on cleaning up the area. I'm looking to build infrastructure. I'm looking to build a mini straw market in the community. I'm looking to build a mini theater. I'm looking to build low-cost homes in the community. I'm looking to have tourist attraction by local bars in the community. My friend Roach, he has a bar on the end of Lewis Street. I'm telling him now, get some light bears, have your kitchen open, cook some Bahamian food, and open your place around 10 o'clock every day. Tell 5 so we can have guests come over. I'm saying the same thing to my friend Kermie and Tiger, who owns a bar on Comfort Street. I myself is building a restaurant in the Lewis Street area to accommodate and have tourist attraction in my community. We also, like I said, I'm building a scroll market to give those who reside in the community an opportunity to become a part of owning a small business. We are setting up a small business center in our community, and I'm asking my husband and wife, Tim from Laifiki, as we continue to come up with creative ideas on how we can empower the communities to build a small business center in the community. We're going to put a few $1,000 in it, and that $1,000 goes to anyone who wants to learn and get trained in the tourism industry. And we're going to set up a stall for you that when you go through all the training, as you go through the procedure, anger management, money management, how to talk to guests, how to present yourself. And once you qualify, it'll allow you that when we build a mini scrub market, that you can have a stall in the mini scrub market, which will be situated in the community. And other persons we would help that are known as small business to their houses, that is qualified. By being qualified, that means you clean up your community, you make sure that no one is going to attack the guests. When they come in the community, there'll be no cursing, there'll be discipline, so that when they come in the community, they would be able to walk from Lewis Street to Hay Street to the protected zone. This would be a zone that we're setting up where we would be protecting the guests. And that's what I'm doing now in my community. We're going to take this last call. We can take this last call. Go ahead, caller. You're on Inside Inner City.
I'm Pleasant Agreement Scrooge. Sorry to have to call you back.
Go ahead, Mick.
Let me ask this question very quick. When we talk about our people, we always talk about our people, Scrooge. Over the south side of the ridge of New Providence, there's a ridge that runs from Vinton all the way down to Lyford Key.
Mm-hmm.
On the south side, let me ask you a question. How much Chinese, how much white people, how much Indians, how much foreigners you see walking the street hustling and trying to get a job?
None.
Let me ask you a question. How much people who own things and like Dalbinas, Kellys, and all of them people that go to QC, Queens College, St. Andrews, all the doggone high class schools. When they finish school, where do they go to work? When you go in Kellys and all them different places, I mean Dalbinas and everything, you see the little black people to the doggone in the warehouse serving you. Where are the white people waking? Where do you see white people? Do you see the white people serving gas?
White people serving gas?
But serving gas in any gas station in the island?
No, sir.
Do you see any Chinese serving gas?
No.
Do you see any Indians serving gas?
No.
So where do they work? Where do they go to church? You ever see any white people over the hill in the Church of God of Prophecy?
No, sir.
Where do the white people and the Chinese and all these foreigners, where do they go to church and wait? How come we never see them nowhere? We don't even see them on the Western Fort when we are celebrating our independence celebration.
Mm-hmm.
All we see is a bunch of black, crooked-toed, diamond people.
Oh, the producers say no, he haven't that. Yes. And you were saying that You know, white people are pumping gas and et cetera. White people and Chinese, them ambitious persons. They plan, and they don't bring down their own kind. Persons who own these gas stations are being immense. And, you know, so that's all I have to say on that. But going back to the development. Oh, you have an next caller? You can take this last call. Go ahead. Go ahead, caller. You can take the last
call. Yeah, Squishy. Squish Brown.
Hey.
Yeah, what's going on? Sparky, right. Give me some good laugh, but you know, I ain't going on with that kind of foolishness.
No.
You remember when I was, one of my nephews took the AstraZeneca vaccination about 3 days ago, right?
Yes.
And so he showed me all the paperwork and explain to me exactly what happened, right? That's why I tell you, because we're in a vaccine war, you can't really believe what the people are saying. But we know the amount of adjuvants and stuff they put in the vaccination now. Last year when I called and I said, COVID stands for certificate, right? Mm-hmm. COVID ID, right? That's what COVID stands for, right? He didn't believe me.
Yeah.
Now, he said they have the serial numbers on the vial.
Yes.
So that means that the government have to prove to these people that they are administering this
vaccine.
And they're being compensated for it now. I just wanted to get something clear with the Beeman people. You know, the United States is the reserve currency of the world, right?
Yes.
The banks in America, they're having problems as a result of this economic fallout from COVID, right? And
yes.
When you look at the whole construct, it's no way, you know, I'm sick that people are sitting back and everybody's thinking that this is all about COVID. Now, COVID is not a hoax, right? But when you juxtapose everything that's going on, it's beyond COVID because the repercussions, like, you know why they keep using the term new normal? And I hear people saying, we get vaccinated, we're going back to normal. We're not going to go back to normal. Hence the term new normal. You have Mr. Bill Gates on the TV telling the people when the pandemic is going to start, when it's going over, predicting a new pandemic.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
And also saying that you have to vaccinate 7 billion people and things will be back to normal. But yet still, people, if the whole world is doing one thing, you can't see it's a conspiracy.
Yes.
Where are our minds going? Are we really thinking?
Oh, we just becoming systematic, you
listen,
know.
Listen, brother, man, brother. The new world order, listen to me. H.G. Wells are from 1939. Countless people will die protesting the new world order. It said the new world order will be achieved either by conquest or consent. And many people will die fighting against the new world order. And that is what it said. And so this is from 1939. He wrote a book called The Open Conspiracy. So I don't get very educated people. I don't know where their minds are being funneled down some asshole, right? But it's like, I listened to one guy who's calling. I call the eye open. He called and talked about the Bill Gates. These people really don't know what's going on, you know. This thing is being done overtly, you know, in the name of humanitarianism and philanthropy. It's being done right before our very eyes, all right? The lady who started Learn the Risk.org, Brandy Vaughn, she was found dead after giving evidence against Merck Pharmaceuticals with the Vioxx lawsuits, man. Anyhow, have a good day, man.
Okay, thank you very much. Boy, every time you come, you get agitated. Listen, my brother, all you doing your thing. All the best you can do is educate people. That's all I can say to you. I doing my thing, you doing your thing, and you educating people, and you speak the truth. They say when you speak the truth, the truth comes to fruition. Many things you speak about, my brother, it's happening. So, yes, there's a world, one world order. Yes, many people know it. Some don't believe it. Some people don't believe in conspiracy. You understand? But at the end of the day, it's the truth. It's there. It's just like we're talking about racism in America. And we say, you know, we'd always say, there's no racism in America. Then what happened to Muhammad Ali? What happened to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar? What happened to Jesse Owens? You know, what happened to the lady on the bus? What happened, you know, what, I mean, you know, you understand? So sometimes we forget about the past. We forget about what is certain group agenda. Yes, there are groups out there who are cults. The Ku Klux Klan, you know, is in America, and that's a cult, and we all know, but people today would admit that the Ku Klux Klan does not exist, but we know, and we're seeing it in America, we're seeing it in the court system, we're seeing it in the judges, we're seeing it in the police, we're seeing people who are professionals, who storm the White House, and when we come to find out there are prestige persons who have high degree in great jobs in the country, but we see they're racist. Okay? You understand? So, you're doing a wonderful job, my brother. You know? So, you don't have to get upset and, man, you know, get tired when every time you call the radio talk shows and you believe, like, you're not making no sense. The truth, it all sets you free. The truth is there for everyone to see. You know? I believe in the theory. I believe in the Ku Klux Klan. Huh? I believe in the Illuminati, yes, but my strongest belief is that whoever prays to the Father, believes in the Father, and also does things to fight against oppression is always going to be kept safe in a time of turmoil. So don't care how bad it is and how many cults working against you or whoever was working against you, who God kept is well kept. Yes, and the conspiracies out there, and these things are happening in our country. Yes. You know, when you talked about the conspiracy theory, Hitler created blue eyes. blue-eyed Germans just for the same particular reason in the war. Isn't it true? He was trying to create a superior race, and that in turn turned to the Ku Klux Klan, and everyone wears the sign of Hitler. You understand? So the communists and idealists came out of that. But that was way around before even Hitler, because he had to learn it from somebody. Probably had to learn it from Alexander the Great, who believed in that philosophy. And that has been passed down from generation, and it's in England, and passed down to England. You know, but not everyone who is a white person is involved in it, but it's just a specific group of persons who has an agenda, and it's passed down from generation to generation. You know, if you watch the Black Panther cartoon, you would see where the Belgian king sent a decree to other kings around the world to do this, to subjugate, to go and conquer. So these things are true. These are in books. So, my brother, you're telling the truth. Just don't get upset. Yeah, before we go, we have 5 more minutes, I think. Let me get back to the development part. So, I know that the community I reside in, there's only one thing I can do. All the programs I bring in the community, all the cleanups, that would mean nothing if I don't figure out a way how to empower persons in the community. If I can't bring an economy in the community where I can get at least 40 persons involved in small business in that one small community, then we could create an economy. Our economy is based on the 7 million visitors that comes to our shores every year, record-breaking. And if we could get them to come from Bay Street over the hill in the Grunstown community, which we are providing safety, and we have a time frame for the guests to be over. So we're looking at a 7 a.m. or 6 a.m. to a 5 p.m. to have the guests leave from the ships and come up to our tourist attraction. As I suggested, I'm building a restaurant to sell Bahamian food. And I'm talking about stew fish, stew conch, boiled fish, etc. to sell to our Bahamian guests who comes in the community. My friend Roach and his wife runs a bar. My friend Tiger and his wife, Comfort Street, runs a bar. My next friend runs a bar on Market Street. I'm encouraging all of them as we get together. Let's work as one. And we go put a yellow page out there. And we're going to open our bars and restaurant. And we're going to allow the guests to come and visit us. And we go provide safety. We go provide sports where the tourists could go and enjoy themselves. We'd even create some sports where they could sit down and be in a green space. But the whole object is this. When we start the business empowerment, we'd encourage person to get involved in hair braiding, nail technician, creating junk and water fox, like junk and doors, name each door like Abaco, Andres, Bimini, Cat Island, so that the guests would have an understanding. And when we say this doll is from Cat Island, and we put Cat Island on it, and then they'd ask, well, what is Cat Island? Then we'd give them some history on Cat Island, and we'd tell them there's 700 islands. So we name all the junk new dolls after particular islands, and then they come, we sell them like $10, $15. And this would bring revenue. Girls could braid hair. Some girls could do nails. But the whole thing is, in that one particular area, we create an economy. The scroll market would be the main attraction because you know that guests come in, the community. After they visit a restaurant, they visit the local parks, they visit the local churches, and then we have some historical sites in the community like the Martin Luther King House, Marcus Garvey, Ari Cooper, who gave the prayer for Independence Day. We have Dr. King's father, who visited Mission Baptist Church along with Dr. King. So we have a lot of historical sites that we will train the younger generation in our community to walk the tourist run as they leave with the restaurant and as they leave out the bars. And then if they want a little bit of history, we'd have all that put into one. So we create an economy. So that's local government for us. So I'm not sitting around waiting on the MP. I'm not sitting around waiting on no political party, because I'm tired of sitting around waiting. So I'm doing my own thing as, to say, creating my own local government, and I'm getting everyone involved. And we can create our economy so that when the tourist comes over, they come to Lewis Creek, they have somewhere to go, sit down, drink a beer, eat some food, communicate with the community, and have a wonderful time and recreate the economy. Because remember now, we have close to about 80,000 and 90,000 or 100,000 persons unemployed, or even more persons in the country. And we want to create an echo empowerment zone in the Lower Street, Hay Street, and Taylor Street area. You know why? Because we're close to the town. Same thing can happen in Bantan, same thing can happen in Mason Addition. Further on down in the communities, I don't know if it so can work because we are close. But the money still could trickle down from Lower Street, Hay Street, and Taylor Street. And maybe we decide to put some scroll markets further down as long as the community start to buy in and start to clean up. They start to recognize the opportunity that is available to them if they was to think this way and actually be a thinker and a doer than just sit around and do nothing. So, again, I hope you enjoyed the show. I'm Juanatino Brown, a.k.a. Scrooge or Scroogey, or Daddy, and it's my pleasure to be your host. And I'm never going to stop working for you guys. Remember one thing I told you? I put many programs together, working with Ms. Cheryl Wilson, Lady Cheryl Wilson, the Honorable Tommy Tynecrest, even Marvin Dames, our former, now deceased, Honorable Dr. Bernard Norwich. I worked with former Prime Minister Perry Gladstone Christie. I worked with former Prime Minister Honorable Hubert Alexander Ingram. And the reason I work with these figures is to use my influence to help build my country. So you don't have to be a part of a political party to make change in this country. Okay? I want to thank Guardian Radio for having me on. And Guardian Radio, you're doing a wonderful job, because with me here, many ideas are being taken off the show. Many programs are being implemented because of this show. So I want to give you credit for allowing me to be on, to talk about what can happen in our community, what is affecting our community, how we can make that change in our community. So I want to thank you very much to the management staff, to the producers, and to everyone. And to you guys who listen to Inside the Inner City, you have a wonderful, wonderful good night. See you next week on Guiding Radio 96.9. My producer, Kermit, thank you very much, my brother.